I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you.
Welcome to our sunrise service, which is almost here,
right?
There you go. It's sunrise over the top of the trees. If you're over here, you may be blinded before the end of this service is over. But we are happy today. This is a great day in the Lord, is it not?
Amen.
He is not here. He is risen. And we give praise to our Savior and Lord for the power not only of the cross, but the power, of course, over the grave, and gives to us everlasting life. The messages today will be filled with everlasting life, and that is the story from beginning to end of what God has done for all of us. And we do welcome you today to this time together. See a few others coming. They'll be forced to sit on the front row, won't they? I'm sure they will be. If you can't hear, you can move a little bit closer because Jonathan's coming on up here and is going to open us up with scripture and prayer. He's going to share some big news with you, but first of all, I want to share, where's Rodney? Rodney Putt. Rodney, we're our sorrow for you. Rodney, this past Friday, lost a brother. And then yesterday, one of his sisters has gone home to be with the Lord. So today takes great meaning for you, Rodney, and all of us, and our losses, and our time of heaven, eternal and everlasting life. Jonathan, you want to make that announcement?
Sure. Well, he put me on the spot here, but Tuesday, Kelly Ray and I got engaged, so. Pretty excited about that. We'll be getting married in August, so kind of quick, so y'all pray for us on the wedding planning thing. It's kind of stressful. All right, so Romans 8. Chapter 8, verse 11, reads this way. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning that we come here together, Lord, not to celebrate a myth or some legend or folklore, some fairy tale story, Father, but we come here to celebrate the truth. And the truth is that Jesus Christ, the sovereign God of the universe, became a man. He lived, he died, and 3 days later he rose, and he is alive today, and he reigns today. Father, we don't celebrate some fairy tale. We celebrate the truth. We celebrate your Son. We thank you so much, Father, for what your Son did, Lord. None of us here deserved it, nor will we ever deserve it. We thank you so much for the grace that you displayed that day, Lord. We thank you for your power that you displayed 3 days later, Lord, by raising him from the dead, Lord. We thank you that we can cling tightly to the same hope, Lord, that you will also raise us from the dead one day when we see Jesus. Lord, we love you. We thank you, Lord. We ask, Lord, above all else, that Jesus Christ be glorified and exalted here in this place today, Lord. We love you. We thank you for Christ Jesus and what he has done, Lord. And in his name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Man, he's my better half at all times. I'm going to have to take this out. Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came. Ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior, bearing shame and scoffing rude, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Lifted up was he to die. It is finished, was his cry. But now in heaven, exalted high. Hallelujah, what a Savior. And when he comes, our glorious King, all his ransomed home to bring, then anew this song we'll sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. What a Savior.
Reading from the book of Matthew 27 verses 57 through 66. When it was even, a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph came, who himself had also become a disciple of Jesus. He approached Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Then Pilate ordered that it be released. So Joseph took the body, wrapped it in clean, fine linen, and placed it in this new tomb, which he had cut out into the rock. He left after rolling a great stone against the entrance of the tomb. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were seated there facing the tomb. The next day, which followed the preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember that while this deceiver was still alive, he said, 'After 3 days, I will raise from it again.' Therefore, give orders that the tomb be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come, steal him, and tell the people he has risen from the dead. Then the last deception would be worse than the first." You have a guard of soldiers," Pilate told them. "Go and make it as secure as you know." Then they went and made the tomb secure by setting the stone and setting the guard.
John 21 through 9. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter, the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. When Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb, he saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first, also went inside, and he saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead.
Thank Okay, now you're going to sing with me. We're going to proclaim what he is today. He is Lord. He's risen from the dead, and he is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Would you sing with me? If you want to stand, that's fine. I see some of you are firmly entrenched under your coats, but if you can, if you want to, let's do it. He is Lord.
Let me tell you concerning two little boys. They were brothers, by the way. The first brother is a little older than the first one, and he had a great idea as they had boiled some eggs or were in the process of doing that. And he decided, he said to his smaller brother, he said, I promise you, if you will let me break three eggs over the top of your head, he said, I'll give you $10. Well, the little brother, you know, not believing his older brother, said, sure, sure. He said, well, do you promise? He said, yes, I promise you. And so with that, he said, well, go ahead. He broke the first egg, and the little boy felt the egg kind of break, and it came over the top of his head. He cracked the second one and let it just run and drain over the top of his head. And the little boy braced for the third one, but the third one never came. He said, when are you going to do it? When are you going to do it? He said, I'm not. He said, because if I do the third one, then I've got to pay you. You know, we're filled with empty promises, aren't we? There are empty promises that come to us every day, it seems like. Someone has something they want to sell you, want to give you, want to do for you, but it's always going to cost you, right? There are empty promises. But I'm going to share today three empty things, by the way, are not empty promises at all. Every one of them are full and they're complete. They're the hope that God gives to us through His Son, Jesus Christ, of the resurrection and the power of it. They're empty things, yes. But today we give praise over something that is empty. Empty from what God has given, what He has done only in His power. The first one is an empty cross. An empty cross. If you were to go to Golgotha, to that place of the skull, right after Jesus was crucified and had been buried, you would find there all of the scenes of an execution. You would see very plainly and very clearly that there were bones there. It would not be called the place of the skull without it, unless they were just simply looking at an outcropping of rocks. There would be the death around you there that you would sense and know. There would also be the things such as, well, there would be the thorns that had been brought into a crown, made into a crown. And on every one of those thorns sticking out, it would be a dark color of a blood-marked thorn. You would also sense then, as you looked up and maybe saw that cross, that there were the nails, the three nails that held our Lord. Those three nails would be stained, covered as well with the blood of our Lord. And then there on the ground, of course, all around it would be the blood that not only soaked the back of the cross, the arm pieces of that cross, the headpiece, but it would be all over the ground, and the ground would take on that color of blood that was soaked in it. Let's go back to those nails, though. It weren't the nails. The nails did not hold Jesus to that cross. Jesus could have called 10,000 angels and he could have been taken away immediately. Not the nails that held Jesus, but it was holding our sin, your sin and my sin, the sin that we have of hatred, the sin we have of jealousy, the sin we have of anger, the sin we have of betrayal. And that's the sin of those religious leaders. That was the sin of the people who cried out. That was the sin of Pilate. That was the sin, of course, of Judas Iscariot as he betrayed our Lord. Now, all of us are feeling kind of comfortable right now because I just hadn't named your sin yet, have I? Once I name your sin, once you come up here and begin to confess your sin, all of a sudden it takes on a different meaning. Yes, you've got hatred. Yes, you've got jealousy. Yes, you've betrayed our Lord. Yes, you've even denied Him. But it's not those sins that we talk about. It's the sin maybe we've already experienced yesterday, or we experienced this morning when we fussed at our spouse a little bit. Maybe we fussed at the kids and said, "Hurry up, get dressed. What's going on?" We fussed at them. Maybe some of us, well, we were a little bit envious of something our neighbor has now that we don't have, and we sin. Maybe because of our anger that's out of control, and we sensed it out of control, and we felt ourselves just boiling mad at something that had no reason to be boiling mad about. Or maybe it was the thoughts that we thought in our minds about someone else, and we hated them. God calls that a sin as well. Maybe it was falling asleep at the preacher's sermon. Boy, that's a bad one, right? But there we are, all of us caught in sin. So it was the nails that held our sin to that cross. But when you look up at that cross, Jesus is not there, is He? It's an empty cross. It's an empty cross today. That's why we don't have a cross in our church or around our buildings here, anywhere that has Jesus still nailed to it. Because after 6 agonizing hours hanging on the cross, our Lord shouted out, "It is finished." And when He said it is finished, it was finished. It was over. There was no more need for our Lord. Anytime we sin, you know what we're doing as Christians? We're simply holding Jesus up again for open shame, for everybody to look at Him and say, "That didn't mean a thing. Didn't mean a thing at all." But yet it is empty today. And after those agonizing hours of suffering on the cross, Jesus again shouted, "It is finished." And it's an empty cross. And you can take that as a promise for God, from Him, always from Him. It will always be there for us to rejoice over. There's something else that was empty. Said on this day there was some grave clothes that were empty. We hear and we read about our Lord being buried. There was Joseph of Arimathea. There was Nicodemus. And, not Nicodemus. Who am I trying to say? Come on, help me. He came to Jesus in the middle of the night. Nicodemus, okay, I had him up a tree or something. I don't know. All right, so we got Nicodemus. Both of these guys were what variety? They were Pharisees, weren't they? They were Pharisees. But they were also believers. And God's Word said that these two men had no faith whatsoever as far as being strong in the Lord before. But after the crucifixion, they came alive. And these two men, one, Joseph of Arimathea, went and asked for the body of Jesus from Pilate. Nicodemus was the one, according to the Scripture, that gathered up all of the spices. They took strips of cloth, it says, they wrapped the body of Jesus, and they placed Him there in the tomb of Joseph. They placed Him in this tomb that had never been used. The tomb was usually, as we know, carved out of rock. They placed His body there, and they left. The next morning, the Scripture tells us that these women, John told us, as you heard the Scripture read earlier, that just Mary went to the tomb. And as Mary got to the tomb, she realized or felt or thought someone has stolen the body of our Lord. And she takes off and runs back and tells John and Peter. There sets in the race. When they get there, John arrives earlier. He looks in, but he doesn't go in. Peter runs on into the tomb. And as he does, they come out. I would imagine John now decides to look as well. And they see some things. First of all, these strips of cloth are now just placed there on the shelf, there on the ground perhaps. And the napkin or the handkerchief that has covered our Lord's face has been neatly folded and has been laid there for everybody to see. Now you may ask, what in the world is all of that? And someone talked about the napkin being folded. That was a sign he's coming again. I'm not sure about all of that. That may be the case. But here is what it told them. The Lord's body has not been stolen. Who would take time to take off the grave clothes off of a dead body if you're going to steal his body? And who in the world would spend enough time to fold up the napkin or the handkerchief that was around his face and lay it gently or lay it down right there where he was? That would be silly. What this was telling them that a miracle has happened here. A miracle of what Jesus had told them. If you listen to that scripture, you also heard where it said that when they went in and they looked at it, they did not yet believe the scriptures. Peter and John yet were not even ready and prepared for what they heard, what they had experienced. Jesus had told them, but they did not believe. But when they saw the grave clothes, the empty grave clothes, they believed. A miracle had happened. God's power had been present, and now they began to recall all of the things that Jesus had talked about. Dying, 3 days, resurrected. It was a miracle that day. You've got an empty cross, you have an empty grave clothes, but we all know, don't we? There was an empty tomb that day. The tomb, again, carved out of rock in the side of a hill or side wall of something. And as it was carved out, there was usually a shelf or two or maybe more where bodies of family members. This huge round stone, which could be opened. It was sealed, but it could be with enough strength to open it up to bring in the next family member or the next family member. But here, these disciples discovered, as the women did, and they must have stayed around that tomb as they got there, because the scripture tells us Peter and John left, and when they did, there was an angel that appeared to our ladies that day and shouted unto you, what are you looking for the living among the dead? Don't you know what he has said? He is not here. He is alive. And he's alive forevermore. It's an empty tomb. But that empty tomb tells us very plainly that Jesus Christ is the victor over the grave and the giver of eternal and everlasting life. That's what we're looking for. You can have life in this world. You can have all of the praise and the glory that you want to come to you in this world. But you know what it ends up being? Nothing. It's the eternal life in which we are really striving and look for from our God. You know, that tells me that John 3:16 really is the way, is really the word for every one of us. Quote that with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
I'm going to be reading from Romans 6, 4 through 11. We were therefore buried into him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may have a new life. If we have been united with him like this in death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him, for we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. All right. Pray with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for this beautiful morning that you've given us, this stage you have set for us as we wake up this morning to remember, as Brother Barry has reminded us, that the cross is empty, the burial clothes are empty, that the tomb is empty, Lord, that you have given us new life through Christ. Lord, that you have been about the redemption of your people over and over again, and that you ultimately sent your Son to die on the cross for each and every one of us who are so undeserving. Lord, we just look at this miracle that our Lord performed for us, that you performed for us, that we're just so thankful for. Lord, we pray that we would live our every day, that we would look at this gift, that we would live with joy in our hearts, that it's not just one day out of the year, that we reflect on the life that you've given us through Christ. But Lord, we just thank you for loving us so much. Lord, we pray that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit as you promised, that your Spirit would come. But Lord, we just pray for this day. We lift up this time of joy and remembrance of what you've done for each and every one of us. Lord, we pray for those who might hear this message today and need to make a decision. We pray for them that you would open their hearts to hear the good news. Lord, as we have a time of fellowship together, I just pray that you bless that time. We pray that you would bless this food that we're about to eat to the nourishment of our bodies. It's in Christ's name I pray.
Amen. We do welcome you again, but come to the gym. I think breakfast is ready.
We're ready.
Amen. Let's go.